The Voice of Russia World Service presents another program in the series Christian Message from Moscow. Why am I not a Christian? This is the title of the popular book by celebrated English mathematician and philosopher Bertran Russell, which has been translated into many languages. For our program, however, we have chosen a title similar in form, but essentially opposite in meaning. It is, Why Am I Not an Atheist? The hero of today's program is Andrew Kurayev, deacon at one of the churches in Moscow, lecturer at several institutions of higher education, professor, philosopher, and theologian. But Father Andrew objects to being described as a theologian, saying,
Богослов, ты не слишком звонко, в церковь слишком высокая. В православной традиции известно только три богослова. Это апостол Иоанн Богослов, Симеоновый Богослов.
A theologian. This sounds too high, says Andrew Kurayev. The Orthodox tradition knows of only three theologians, namely St. John the theologian, the favorite disciple of Jesus Christ, Gregory the theologian of the 4th century, and Simeon the theologian of the 10th century. So it seems to me somewhat pretentious to call myself a theologian. A church journalist, though, would be a more proper description.
Well, whatever you say, let it be church journalist. However, it is hard to agree with Father Andrew. A lifetime wouldn't be enough to study the wealth of wonderful works by Orthodox theologians. Books by Andrew Kurayev on comparative theology have sold like hotcakes. Some of them have already become bestsellers. Mark, by the way, the paradoxical fact that super-serious Orthodox books are in great demand in Russia today. Some have worked up quite a boom. Well, it can't be helped considering the rapidity with which Russians en masse are returning to Orthodox spirituality. And books by Andrew Kurayev have made a great contribution to this process. Not only his books, though. Father Andrew gives lectures in Moscow and in the provinces. Lecture halls on these occasions cannot accommodate all those wishing to listen to him. Perhaps the exceptionally intense activity of this priest has been warmed up by the healthy, booming energy of young age. Indeed, Andrew Kurayev is just a little over 30. His ascetic missionary activity has repudiated the old, unfair opinion that Orthodox priests are poor missionaries. Here is another stroke to the portrait of Father Andrew associated with this spiritual song.
Что ты спишь, восстань, душе моя, или самой себя не вынести. Так открой псалтырь Давидову и покайся судье. Боже, Боже мой, помилуй мя по велице Твоей милости и по множеству щедрот очисть. Беззаконие мое. Боже, Боже мой, помилуй мя по велице Твоей милости и по множеству щедрот очисть беззаконие мое. Вспомнил жизнь свою прошедшую, нерожденным позавидовал. Отойдите, воды бурные, убегай душе от злых, дай же, Господи, душе моей покаяние Давидова по молитвам Богородицы, по молитвам всех святых.
We have heard one of the present-day Orthodox monks by the name of Raman singing to his own accompaniment on the guitar. We had a special conversation with Father Andrew about this musical recording, because it is unprecedented in itself, although not unique in a series of similar recordings made both in our country and abroad. The point is that for many centuries, Orthodox church singing has been performed strictly a cappella, as the church canons prescribe. But fleeting time inevitably brings innovations. Now you can hear monastic singing to the accompaniment of a guitar. What is Father Andrew's attitude to such innovations? As it turned out, he feels quite disposed towards them, only if they are discreet and felicitous.
Дай же, Господи, душе моей покаяние Давидова по молитвам Богородицы, по молитвам всех святых. Открываю книгу старую, покрываю плечи мантией и словами покаянными пред иконами молюсь. В беззакониях зачался я, во грехах рожден я матерью, окропиши мя, очищуся, паче снега убелюсь.
A poignant detail has turned out. An unshakable pillar of true orthodoxy, as Deacon Andrew Kurayev appears to be today, was preparing himself for quite an opposite ministry. He was going to devote himself to atheistic propaganda. To which Andrew Kurayev was born and in which he was raised, carried the stamp of elitism. His father, a celebrated philosopher, often went abroad to work there for long and to stay there together with his family. Unlike other people in the then Soviet society, those who went abroad were privileged. They enjoyed better living conditions, somewhat greater freedom, greater access to information. In the eyes of people who could not go out of the Soviet Union, those who could go abroad on business trips were people belonging to a different dimension, to a higher order. As a child, Andrew lived in Eastern Europe. Back home in the Soviet Union, he regarded his mates who didn't have jeans or chewing gum as savages. That is how he himself recollects that time, stressing he was not alien to the temptations of the so-called consumer society. As a student at the Department of Philosophy of the Moscow State University, he was sitting for an exam in philosophy, his favorite subject. He got an A and a request from the examiner to convey best regards to his philosopher father. It was at that point that the young man decided never again would he be presented as a celebrity's son. He would go into a field where the name of his brilliant philosopher father was of no consequence. Eventually, he changed over to the chair of scientific atheism. Later, he even made postgraduate studies at the Institute of Philosophy of the Academy of Sciences. As a result of all these studies, he was steeped in the critical attitude to belief in God and stuffed with atheistic arguments. What happened then? How did the skeptical mind of a Soviet atheist make a turnabout? We shall try to explain this, but warn you straight away that all the words expressed will still leave behind them a mystery of divine influence on human life, a mystery of the Holy Spirit who breathes where he wills. Let us open the book by Andrew Kurayev entitled, Is It All the Same? How to Believe?
One becomes a Christian not because somebody has driven one into a corner by pure arguments. Simply, one's soul at a point comes in touch with the divine, or as one Orthodox theologian put it, nobody would ever become a monk unless he once saw the shining of eternal life in the face of another person. A believer differs from a non-believer simply in that the range of his experience is greater, just as a person with an ear for music differs from those who do not hear the harmony of musical chords. If a person has the experience of an encounter with God, so much changes in this world for him. But if he loses it, so much gets darkened. One young man wrote at the dawn of the 19th century, If a person has been given this virtue of union with Christ, he meets the blows of fate with calmness and inner tranquility, opposing courageously the storms of passions and withstanding fearlessly the rage of evil. How can you fail to endure suffering if you know that by persisting in Christ and working zealously, you glorify God himself? Later, after rejecting Christ, the author of these remarkable words about a lifetime union would write only about alienation. The name of this young man was Karl Marx.
There is an account of how exactly the conversion of Andrew Kurayev, a student of the Moscow State University, happened in reality. In the same book, Is It All the Same How to Believe?, we read,
For me, a turning point occurred during one wordless encounter at the St. Sergius Monastery of the Trinity. Sometime at the beginning of 1982, I happened to be there as a student of the chair of atheism and a young Communist League activist. I had to accompany a group of Hungarian student tourists. I did not remember the worship service and was little interested in architecture and history. But when we were coming out of the Cathedral of the Trinity, a miracle happened. Walking out in front of me was a young man from another group. Just two steps before reaching the threshold, he suddenly turned around briskly to face me. But he was not looking at me. He was looking at the icons in the heart of the church in order to make a sign of the cross at them and to receive a blessing before coming out. I just turned out to stand between him and the icons. For the first time in my life, I could see the eyes of a believer so close. No, there was nothing mysterious or enigmatic about them. A similar impression is often put on, for some obscure reason, by actors playing priests. The eyes of this young man, however, were just bright, meaningful, and lively. And a thought penetrated me. Why does this guy, who was taught the same stuff at school as I was, know something completely closed to me for all my religious studies? Indeed, he knows whatever I was taught, but it's he who feels at home here while I'm a stranger. Does it mean that to become a believer, one should know something that atheists do not know? Then I came back to Moscow, a city where I had no believers among my acquaintances, but I found an access to Orthodox books and understood from them that I was not the first on earth to search for a completely new spiritual experience. I also understood that I can find such people and stand next to them in church, as if saying, Let me try too. Indeed, we do not have to create anew our own Church of the Apostles. It is there to join and to accept what is not made with hands, which is the joy of communion as a gift and a legacy.
In the books by Andrew Kurayev, there are many rare facts and penetrating observations concerning the tortuous ways of human spiritual life. They are brilliantly supported by references to the Holy Scripture and writings by the Holy Fathers of the Church. The author also takes resort to poetry. Here is an example.
To know God, one should be God. To love and worship Him, unknown, one has to have the heart alone.
We had an opportunity to meet Father Andrew and ask him questions. One of them was as follows. Didn't he, on his way to faith and the Church, feel a certain contradiction between his scholarly cast of mind, molded from childhood, and the need to take a religious doctrine on trust? This is what he answered.
А православне богословие – это мир тоже очень глубокой и утонченной науки. Это церковное богословие, и патристика, и, скажем, религиозная философия.
The Orthodox theology, too, is a world of very profound and sophisticated scholarship, Father Andrew answers. From the philosophical point of view, Orthodoxy is the most attractive faith for me. But not only from the philosophical point of view. Orthodoxy, whichever of its aspects you take, is the richest of all Christian confessions. In it you find the most developed art of worship, liturgics, and the wondrous beauty of ritual. And take the Church theology, or patristics, or, say, Russian religious philosophy. And on top of that, I was born in an Orthodox country, a fact that makes me especially happy.
Still, how has your scholarly mentality manifested itself in the Orthodox environment?
Я не думаю, что вот, собственно, научная закваска должна угасать, когда человек приходит в церковь. Подходя к церкви, надо снимать шляпу, а не голову отнять. Разум – это ведь, как отец Алексей Мичев был такой...
I don't think, says Andrew Kurayev, that the scholarly mentality should fade away when a person comes to church. Approaching a church, one should take off one's cap, not one's head. Reason is the workhorse of the heart. Reason will pasture in whatever field the heart sends it to. I will say to my reason, go and study the laws of physiology, and it will. I will tell my reason to study poetry, and it will go and study the development and laws of poetry. And if the heart says, heed the Lord, and try to understand the gospel's truths and the holy fathers, reason may prove helpful here too. But one should bear in mind that reason cannot fathom everything in existence and in the human being. Here we come to the field where problems end and mysteries begin.
Orthodoxy has been often accused today of excessive conservatism, allegedly obsolete canons, long worship services conducted in an unintelligible church Slavonic, and exhausting fasts. What does Deacon Andrew say to this?
Православные в сегодняшнем мире похожи на альпинистов в летнем городе. Представьте, жара, в длинных тапочках тоже жарко.
The Orthodox Christians in today's world are like mountaineers in a summer camp, says Father Andrew. Imagine the heat in a city when one feels hot even in linen slippers. Suddenly, you see people walk, carrying at the ready warm caps, parkas, and thick boots with spikes in them. What are ice axes for in a city? What are spikes for on the asphalt? But if at least one of these things is left behind below, here, the price of having it thrown out may prove to be very dear high up there. So it is in Orthodoxy. Everything is calculated for moving up in an arduous ascent. Once on the spiritual heights up there, you will understand why the fasts, the church Slavonic, such long worship services and no rows in churches, what the veneration of saints signify and what the icon offers to you. But however necessary the complex equipment may be for mountaineers, they themselves have to climb up, for the spikes and ice axes will not carry them to the top. People carry whatever can help them to climb up. In Orthodoxy, the truth is given with the room for ascent.
Я сказал, что где-то журавли курлыкают. Я сказал, что где-то ветер облака, пыльные пустырники пахнут повеликою, и в траве смеется капля василька, пыльные пустырники пахнут повеликою, и в траве смеется капля василька.
You've heard a program called Why Am I Not an Atheist, which told you about the ways to God covered by the renowned religious figure in Moscow, Andrew Kurayev. The program in the series Christian Message from Moscow was prepared by producer Vladimir Dyomin, author and music editor Nadezhda Pronina, and narrators Svetlana Yakimenko and James Donoher. We are looking forward to meeting you at your radio sets in a week's time, and will be glad to receive your letters with responses to the programs in this series.
Звуки православные над землей плывут. Я сказал, что где-то образ Богородицы утешает страждущий богомольный люд. Я сказал, что где-то образ Богородицы утешает страждущий богомольный люд. Я сказал, что где-то огоньки колышутся свечи восковые и кадильный дым. Я сказал, что где-то край, где вольно дышится, край, где все пропитано воздухом святым. Я сказал, что где-то клобуки и мантии, канонарх уверенно возглашает стих. Я сказал, что где-то служит Богу братья. И еще сказал я один из них. Я сказал, что где-то служит Богу братья. И еще сказал я один из них.